Let us stand. What is my light and my salvation? Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? I ask, and this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. Hide me in the shelter of his tabernacle, and set me high upon the rock. Then and his tabernacle will I sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord.
He's a keeper. He's a healer of the living. praise, every praise, every praise, every praise is to our God.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. We will have, if there is anyone who would like to have a final viewing, here's your opportunity. Please come and do it now. This will be the final viewing. You may be seated. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. This morning, God is still good. God has always been good, and God will always be good. This morning, God is good. And therefore, every praise is to our good and our gracious God. When we come to funerals as Christians, we don't come like everybody else go. Because for us, there's this weird anomaly that's occurring. All right, now. Peter talks about weeping and rejoicing at the same time. We're going to weep, and you're going to remember, and you're going to weep, and you're going to reflect, and you're going to weep. But it's we're strange people, at those of us who know Jesus, because we can weep and rejoice. Yeah. The same time, because our God has made us some promises that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. He's made that promise. And to be absent from the body for the believer is false. For Paul says, to live is Christ and to die is gain. And then we know that we are saying not just goodbye, I'll never see you again. We're saying goodbye and I'll see you later. Because we have a promise from God that we grieve, but we don't grieve as the rest who do not have hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, we know that there is going to be a shout from heaven. And the voice of the archangel of God, the trumpet of God shall sound, and the who remain shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. And forever we all shall be. There will be a reunion around the throne of God, and we anticipate that day. So yes, that's why we can say praise the Lord, and that's why we can declare God is good. We have an order of service that we are going to submit to, because this is what this family has asked for, and we're going to follow it as the Lord gives and as the Lord allows. Thank you for those who have worship already reminding us that every praise belongs to God. And our Tarleton and our Smyrna choir are going to lead us in Oh How Precious. There's going to be some scripture readings, Old Testament from Reverend Patrick Jones and Reverend Jimmy Derry, and then a prayer of comfort from Reverend Clyde Davis Jr. There is one change at the resolution and acknowledgments. Sister Paulette Jones will be reading that for us. Then there is a slideshow. Expressions, as you can see, people have been designated. There is the possibility for three others, limited in 2 minutes, to provide additional expressions. Then Sister Terry Berry will bless us with our crown, and then we will hear the man of God as he proclaims the word of God. Amen. Amen. Turn you over now into the hands of Sister Gwen Tarleton and the Smyrna Baptist Church singer.
Beginning, Jesus, he's my ending, Jesus. more I call him, the better I feel. The more I call him, the better I feel. The more I call him, the better I feel. The more I call him, the better I feel. Jesus, 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 Jesus. I love Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
The book of Job, 19th chapter, verse 25 and 26. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God.
Good word.
Amen.
Good word.
John 5, chapter 5, verses 24 through 29. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and they that hear shall live. For as the Father has life in himself, so has he given to the Son to have life in himself, and has given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming, in which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice, and shall come forth. They that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of condemnation, of damnation.
Can I be honest with y'all for just 1 second? I'm trying to gather myself after that great exhortation about the name of Jesus.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And there is no greater prayer of comfort than the name of Jesus. When I am going through Jesus, when my grief has overtaken me, Jesus. When sorrow has set in, Jesus, when there's no one else knocking at my door, calling my phone, telling me and trying to find out how I am doing, there is no greater name than the name of Jesus. So here we are, precious Father. We find ourselves at your throne of grace, searching and looking for comfort in the midst of our sorrow. While we are preparing ourselves for the great goodbye, we find comfort in knowing that as our brother enters into the gates of heaven, he is finding himself with a great moment of hello in the presence of Jesus. He doesn't have to deal with sickness anymore, just Jesus. No more sorrow and pain anymore. Just Jesus. No more disappointment. No more letdown. Just Jesus. Hallelujah. So God, we come before the family on today and we tell them, when it seems like there is no way out, just call on Jesus. When it seems like grief has overtaken, just call on Jesus. When it seems like because we are missing a loved one in our lives that we can't go on anymore, just call on Jesus, for there is comfort in your name. Amen.
Now we will have the reading of the resolution. Sister Paulette Jones.
Good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
Smyrna Baptist Church, 3315 Laura Coppy, Houston, Texas, 77093. Reverend Terrence O'Neill, pastor teacher. Okay. Resolutions. Saturday, January 14, 2023. The family and friends in love and memory of Brother Sidney Davis, Jr. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our afflictions, 2 Corinthians 1, 3-4. We are in this place, in this world, for a limited time, and with the breath of the infant begins the race to the grave, a race everyone must run, whereas in the providence of God, he has brought to a close to the life of Brother Sidney Davis. The officers and members of the Smyrna Baptist Church in Houston, Texas, feel that it is befitting to express their sympathy to the family during the passing of Brother Sidney Davis. We commend you to him who knows best and will always do right. Whereas Brother Sidney Davis was a caring and loving person towards everyone in his company, his love for the Lord and the Smyrna Church was shared every Sunday when he greeted members and visitors while serving as an usher for 19 years. He lived his life devoted to his family, his community, his church, and his Lord. He will truly be missed. Be it resolved that we bow in humble submission to him who never makes a mistake, and remind the family to be encouraged by remembering the words of our Lord. I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. John 11:25-26. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be given to the family and a copy kept in the church archives. To the family, we know your loss is deep, and your sorrow is great, but we want you to know that we share in your sorrow. More importantly, we recognize that this loss is heaven's gain. Humbly submitted on the 14th of January, 2023, by the officers and members of the Smyrna Baptist Church, Dr. Terrence O'Neill, pastor teacher. Okay, I have one more to read, and then I have a few to announce. There are quite a few of them, but I'm going to read one more. This is from Live Oak Church of God in Christ. Resolution. And the pastor is Elder Terry L. Walter, Sr. January 14, 2023. Resolution. In the memory of Brother Sidney Davis, Ray Davis, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal into heaven. 2 Corinthians 5:1. We, the officers and members of the Live Oak Church of God in Christ, express our deepest sympathy and condolences to the family of Brother Sidney Ray Davis. Whereas the hearts of the pastor and members of the Live Oak Church of God in Christ are saddened because of the death of your beloved one, Brother Sidney Davis. And whereas he will be missed by his family, friends, and acquaintances in Kirbyville, San Jack, Bunwar, Houston, and other areas of Texas and Louisiana. And whereas the warm and contagious smile of Brother Davis will be missed by all who knew him. And whereas his appointment with death came at a time that we are never prepared for, it was an appointment that he had to keep. He was reminded through scripture that no man knows the day or the hour when the Son of Man shall appear. We also send the reminder of our final moment in the time that is appointment that we cannot postpone, because the scriptures in Hebrews 9:27 says, and it is appointed unto man once to die, but after that, this the judgment. We therefore resolve to believe that our brother Sidney Davis might say, I am not gone. I remain there beside you, just in the different form. Look for me in your heart, and there you will find me. In our love, which ever lives on, which forever lives on. In this moment, when we feel alone, look for me in your thoughts, and there you will find me, in sweet memories that burn strong. Every time a tear forms in your beautiful eyes, look to the heavens, and there you will see me, smiling down from God's glorious skies. And though we don't always understand why things happen as they do, we further resolve to stand firm in our confidence in God's word that says, all things work together for good of those who love, to them who are called according to his purpose. And knowing that God loves us, we resolve to trust the wisdom of our loving and caring God and encourage the Davis family to do the same. We also resolve to pray for you, and we encourage you to trust God with all that is within you, so that when we all stand before that great judgment throne, we can hear the Lord say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Finally, we resolve to encourage you to keep precious memories of Brother Sidney Davis forever etched on the pages of his memories. Finally, we resolve that a copy of this resolution will be given to the family of Brother Sidney Davis, and that copy retained in the archives of Live Oak Church of God in Christ. Humbly submitted, the 14th day of January, 2023. Elder Terry L. Walder, Senior Pastor, Live Oak Church of God in Christ. LaShonda Thomas, Secretary. Amen. Okay, I have a few just to acknowledge. And we have one from Jasper District 1 Women's Department, Missionary Joyce Taylor, District Missionary. St. John Missionary Baptist Church, Dr. Terrence D. Grant, Malone Pastor. The Church Without Walls, Dr. Ralph Douglas West, Pastor Founder. Belgrade Baptist Church, Pastor Brandon Ray. Robinson Memorial District, Sour Lake, Texas. Superintendent Greg E. Mitchell, Missionary Sonia McCain. True Grace Temple Missionaries, Kirbyville, Texas. Elder Lionel, Elder Pastor. And the last one, Welcome Tabernacle, Elder Lionel, Elder Pastor.
Thank Amen. You. Thank you so much, Sister Jones. Thank you so much.
I will bless the Lord at all times. The praises shall be continuously in my mouth. My soul shall make a boast of the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord and see me, and let us exalt his name together. Psalms 34:1-3. We, the Newton High School senior class of 1974, pause here today to pray pay our last respect to our beloved friend and classmate, Brother Sidney Ray Davis Jr. A fool's day's work finished. God in his wisdom sent down from the shining courts of glory a beautiful glorified messenger and ordered to release Brother Davis from the woes of life and cause a deep sleep on which only God knows the awakening. The death of Brother Sidney Ray Davis Jr. again emphasized that no one is superior to the last call, which is common to all beings. Again, we are reminded that the ways of man lead through the grave, and they who walk with the Master here shall not tarry in the grave, but shall be led gently on into the land and light of beauty. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is your victory? Therefore, my beloved brother, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. To the family, we say find comfort in knowing when we live for God and make him our hope while on earth, death and grave have no victory. Sidney has been called home, but he's not in a grave. He's been lovingly called into the glory where no more death, no more sorrow, and no more pain. He is resting in the loving arms of Jesus. Resolve that we, the 1974 senior class of Newton High School, bow in humble submission to the will of God, who he sees all and he knows all. We understand your grief, for we too feel the pains of sorrow, loss due to death of our beloved friend and classmate. To the entire family, we say our love and prayers are with you. We entreat you to console yourself in hope of a great reunion. We bind your hope through the Master of Life and remind you that you will see one again. For we shall meet the loved ones gone. We shall know, as we all know, some sweet day by and by. Homily submitted, Newton High School Senior Class of 1974. So with the class of 1974 who are here, would you please stand?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Thank you so much. Amen. And we will give this to the family.
Amen. Thank you so much. Now there's a slideshow presentation, and immediately after the slideshow presentation, there are expressions as a father and grandfather, Sister Kimberly Grant, as a brother, Brenda Davis Farr, as a co-worker, Rodney Anderson, and as a church member, Reverend Reginald Terry from Smyrna Baptist Church.
Soft and warm.
when the sun settles down and it takes a lovely form, that's the golden time of day. Oh,
you know my name. Hey, hey, hey. not beneath you, Lord. So you know my name. Oh, yeah. Oh, how you walk with me. And oh, how you walk with me. Has he been walking with you? And oh, how you talk with me.
Oh, how you talk.
Seconds and somebody just say something to him. Come on, raise up your voice and tell him how awesome he is. God, you're faithful. You're the lover of my soul, the keeper of my life. God, I adore you. God, we honor you tonight. Somebody just.
Amen and praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Now our time for expressions. Sister Kimberly Grant.
Giving all honor and praises to God, the ministers on the pulpit, deacons, family, friends. Just bear with me. God, give me strength today. So, thank you guys all for the calls and the texts and just being there. Many that know me know that I always call my daddy my first love. My daddy was my everything. He was my friend. He was there all the times I needed him. And I cry not because I have any regrets, but I cry because of how much I'm gonna miss him. I just recall my dad when I was younger. He would get us snacks, we would watch movies. And I'll be honest, I'm not sure we went from watching Rainbow Bright, Care Bears. Then we end up watching Die Hard and Top Gun, and I'm not really sure if I should have been watching that, but those were our movies, and we still watch them. My dad was just always present. The only time I think I can really recall really getting on him, because my dad played softball a lot. And I remember I told him, I said, you keep playing softball, you're gonna turn into a softball. But that was his thing and he loved it. He always had a smile on his face. He was always just happy unless the Dallas Cowboys lost. Because then it would go, it wasn't his day. But one thing that just resonates so much for me is that my dad was just always present. No matter what I was going through, he would be in the middle of work, and I just remember I would be upset about something. Maybe it was a relationship. Maybe it was something I was stressed out at work. I remember I'd call him, and I would hear him tell his coworkers, he's like, this is my baby calling. I got to step out. He did that with everything. And if you know him, you know he was passionate about everything and he was going to debate you. But when I called, he just was so patient. He never made me doubt how much he loved me. He always made sure I knew it. And even talking to people who called me, they always said that, you know, your dad just said how proud he was of you. And he told me that. I am so proud that I was his daughter. Because he was there for everything. He's the greatest father I could have ever asked for. And Paw, y'all, he loved his grandkids, his girls. our last memory would be Thanksgiving. My girls knew to go get his blanket for him to lay on the floor, and they would have their sleepovers. And he said, you know, I thank God he allowed me to meet them. So, Lord, I just, you know, I'm a little angry with you, Lord, because you took one of my best friends that I could call on, but I know that this is just a wake-up call. So I know at funerals they always say it's not for those who are not with us anymore. They're for us who are still present. So I'll say this, like I know how much my dad told me he loved me. If it's someone you need to tell that to, make sure you do it. Make sure they know it. If you don't know God, get to know him. Be present, because this is that message, and I want my dad's legacy to remember that smile. And I know he knew the Lord, so I have no doubt in my mind where he is. But I'm going to miss him. So I thank you all for being here.
And I will rejoice and be glad in it. I'm Brenda Davis, for the oldest sister of Sidney, but I mean, he's my older brother, my big brother. So Kim, beautiful job. He did love you. He loved his family. He loved you and those girls. He loved you. I mean, what more can I say? When I didn't get to see him for Thanksgiving because he was at your house, but it's okay. But anyway, I just rose to say that Bo is in a better place. And he was Bo. Okay, so to y'all, he's Sidney. To me, he's Bo. He's my big brother. He's Bo. He's Saddlehead. He's Sidney. What else they used to call him? But they had many names for him. But he was Bozo. But to me, he's just Bo. So I praise God for him. I praise God for the opportunity, like she said, of knowing him for 62 years. I just praise God. There was, as Linda liked to say, there was 9+. There was 10, then we had 7 more brothers that Daddy blessed us with. So I'm proud to stand here. I can't say enough about Bo. He was a good daddy. I know he was a good daddy. He was a good husband. I know that he was a good husband. Because he used to come to my house and be on the phone, and I could hear some of the conversation. Not that I was listening. He was a Dallas Cowboy fan. Baby, when the Cowboys was losing, him and Randy, they just go down on the Cowboys. I love the Cowboys. That's my team to this day. I can remember we were at Dina's for one of the family reunion, Memorial Day functions, and Bo was laying there on the floor. It was a house full of people. And if I'm not mistaken, I think the San Antonio Spurs was playing my team, the Miami Heat. And we thought he was sleeping. Tim Duncan hit a shot, and Bo jumped up, and he wired it up and did that. And everybody in the house just went to laughing. He was just that type of person. Yeah, he was mad at times about the Cowboys and this and that, but he was a good person. I love him. I'm going to miss him, the arguments and the disagreements and the good times. But he was just a good person. Like I said, he was a good daddy. He was a good brother. He was a tie pair. Him, Linda, and Margaret, I can faithfully say, Lord, thank you, that when other families were in need, other people were in need, they would send. They would give their last. Him, Margaret, and Linda would be the first one to give. And, you know, I just think that's a blessing. I don't know. I could talk all day, but I won't. Because I've been told that 2 minutes was my limit. And I said, well, I'm sister. No. So anyway, I see you looking, Dave. I see you shaking your head. I know it's time. But we love him. We're going to miss him. We're going to miss him. Y'all pray my strength in the Lord.
My name is Rodney Anderson. I met Sidney Davis in 2005 while working at Universal ENSCO. I had a new client, and they had a time-sensitive project that they needed to get done, and to complicate matters, the company was using a not-standard software package, so I had to find someone who knew the program. That's when I met Sidney. He not only knew the software package, he He knew other designers that could operate the program. Sidney was able to convince his friend, Linda Bolton, to leave her current job to come work with us on her project. Linda was scheduled to start her new job on Monday. Sidney was able to talk Linda into starting her new job on Saturday, followed by work on Sunday. Linda also had a friend, Eloy, who also knew the program. So in just a couple of days, Sidney had put together a small team to work on the project. Sidney was my new hero. Through his knowledge and relationships and hard work, he helped build a team that was able to provide the project deliverables by the needed deadline. The success of this project was largely due to the efforts of Sidney. The client was happy, and her small team went on to provide this company with engineering services on over 250 projects during the next 8 years. Normally, designers specialize in one area of expertise in the industry, be it mapping, piping, civil, or electrical. Sidney was able to work in all of these fields. Working in the Houston oil and gas engineering consulting business, you're accustomed to market turndowns. Most people would worry about, what do I do when I get laid off? Not Sidney. He would always say, if I get laid off, I'm just going to throw the tools in the back of my truck and drive around Houston. Sidney's father was a carpenter, and he made sure all of his sons got plenty of opportunity to learn the craft when not in school. Sidney said that he would find carpenter jobs by driving around Houston, stop by a house under construction. Sidney would walk around the house under construction and would photograph the areas of the house where the current contractor was in violation of Houston City building codes. He would then share these with the homeowner and offer his services to fix. I remember contacting Sidney on two separate occasions after he was laid off, and both times I called and found him on a roof of a house. Sidney was one of the most resourceful and industrious people I've ever known. When Sidney was not at work and not in church, he would be at the ballpark. It is my understanding that as a young man, Sidney was quite the ball player, specializing in hitting home runs. Sidney would get recruited to join teams for their tournaments. Sponsors would give him high-end bats, pay travel expenses. Sidney's reputation in the league grew. When Sidney stepped to the plate, the outfielders would move to the back of the fence line, hoping to catch the ball before it sailed over the fence, adding another home run to the list. That was before Sidney's accident at Emancipation Park. Sidney was playing outfield, and a batter hit a long ball in the area of the field where Sidney was making a diving catch when he ran headfirst into a park light pole. Sidney spent the next 7 days in intensive care. The injury left permanent damage to Sidney's vision and hearing. Sidney tried to get back into the sport at the level he was prior to the accident, but was unable to. Sidney said that prior to the accident, as a batter, the ball looked like a large grapefruit. After the accident, it looked like a marble. Sidney did not give up the sport. He just changed positions. Sidney became an umpire and continued this activity in the sport up to recent times. He even met his lovely wife, Lily, in the sports setting. Sidney's topic of conversation that would brighten him up the most was talking about his family. His daughter graduated with a degree in engineering, worked at a Houston company in the energy-related field, started her own company in the school tutoring field, and she had given him grandchildren. During the past couple years, Sidney and I would visit on the phone, and I could tell that his current favorite activity was hanging out with the grandkids. I am blessed. That is the answer that I normally got from Sidney when I made my morning greeting, "How are you doing, Sidney?" Sidney lived his life with the attitude that he was blessed to have friends that he worked with. He was working at a job that he enjoyed, and he had a family that he cared about and a church in which to worship. In closing, I would like to say that I feel that I am the one that's been blessed to have known Sidney as my friend.
Praise the Lord, everybody. The Lord. Amen. Giving all praises to Almighty God and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to our pastor, Pastor Terrence O'Neill, to all these other peculiars of the gospel ministry by way of pastorage. What can I say about Brother Sidney Davis? His sister kind of stole my thunder. Several years ago, I had the privilege with Reverend and Sister Jimmy Derry to go to his hometown and the homegoing services of their mom. And I found out his nickname was Bo. And that's all I ever called him after that. He would come to church, "Hey T, what's up, Bo?" He would call me often. Sidney developed a deep passion for the Word of God. He loved Sunday school. He loved Smyrna Baptist Church. And when he came there under the pastorship of our late pastor, Larry Wayne Jackson, Sr., he saw something in Sidney that God has shown all of us. Here's a man who will become a great witness and testifier of my goodness. He would often call me from work when he was trying to witness to some co-workers. They don't understand what this scripture means. I say, "Sidney, they have taken it out of context." That's what I'm telling them. One of his favorite scriptures was 2 Corinthians 5:17. He was trying to explain it one day at work. Oftentimes we heard it. I say, "Sidney, we all thought like that, out of context coming up. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new." We always talk what you did that's coming back to you. Sidney got to Smyrna and realized that was dealing with theologically positional death. You're no longer positioned in Adam, but you're positioned in Christ once you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Sidney loved his wife. He loved his family. He loved his daughter, but he cherished them granddaughters. So in my closing, I was to speak to him as a church member. I want to share this with Lily, to Kimberly, to all of his siblings. Bo is with Jesus. If I can leave anything with you biblically, it's simply this. When I thought about, give me a scripture, Holy Ghost, and I felt a tap on my left shoulder. When I looked over my shoulder to see who it was, the Apostle Paul said, "Remind them of that particular pericope I left in 2 Corinthians 4:18. Paul said, "While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal." You see, that's not Sidney Bo Davis laying there. Yeah. That's that old house he used to live in. Yeah. Paul said, "Go on and let them know," chapter 5, verse 1, "for we know." That word "for" in the Greek is translated "because we know." Yeah. Now, there's a qualifying statement there. We who? We that are tied up, wrapped up, tangled up, twisted up in Jesus. What do we know? We know not expositionally, not exponentially, but we know experientially that our earthly house is going to be resolved one day. And on New Year's, diabetes got Sidney. Gout got Sidney. High blood pressure got Sidney. But that was that old tent he used to live in. But he got a house right now, building, right, not now. Made with hands. May God bless you and keep you.
God bless you. God bless you, Reverend Terry. God bless you. The family has allowed opportunity for three more individuals to offer expressions. Let's please limit those expressions to 2 minutes. I see one, I see two, I see three. Okay, it's a mic here, it's a mic here. You can go here or here, either one. Praise the Lord.
I don't know about you, but I can't have church today.
Right now.
Yes. My heart is broken. My eyes is filled with tears. But I tell you, Bo made it home.
Yes, ma'am.
And I just stand to encourage my nieces and my nephews. That's that old house. Bo moved the other day. He moved to a brand new house. And we come looking to the hills from whence cometh our help. Let me tell you, all our help comes from the Lord. Let me tell you, nieces and nephews, Bo, the great debater, is standing somewhere between third base and home plate. Saying, come on, you can make it.
Mm.
He's up there encouraging us. So, Randy, dry your tears. Shed your tears. But listen to your big brother.
Amen.
He don't, I'm not talking to Bo. I'm talking to the rest of us. Bo's journey is over. Ours is still going on. So we just got to make sure, if you want to see him again, you just gotta make sure we make preparation now while a breath remains in our body. Because when Bo heard the voice of God, he couldn't put it off no longer. He had to answer. As much as he loved you, Kim, he couldn't say, no, Lord, I got to stay here with my baby girl and my two granddaughters. He had to answer the call. And we're going to have to do the same. We're going to have to answer that call. Because when God called our name, we got to answer, just like Bo did.
Amen.
So Bo made it in. He's somewhere around the throne of God. See, when Bo closed his eyes, he opened them on the other side.
Amen. Amen.
So I won't say goodbye to Bo. I won't say goodbye. Because, see, Bo life just started the other day when he entered the pearly gates of heaven. See, he's alive now, and he's really living. He's alive forevermore. He's living like he never lived here on earth.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
See, amen.
When God said, welcome home, son. See, Bo always had a smile on his face. When he saw Jesus, his face really lit up. And he said, thank God I made it. Thank God. He said, I don't have to imagine anymore. Amen. He said, because when I see Jesus, hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen. Go ahead.
Let me tell you. It's all right. I won't say goodbye to both. I just say, live on, both. Live on in the sunshine.
Amen.
First, giving honor to God, the pastor and the pulpit, the ministers. I would like to acknowledge all of the softball players and the umpires. Could y'all please stand?
Wow.
Male and female.
Wow.
Thank you. You may be seated. Let me say this on the behalf of the gladiators. We used to be a buck wild team. No one on our team was over 6 feet tall, so we had attitudes. And we used to fight, Pastor. We used to fight every other game, thanks to our coach, Carl Jones. But when Sidney came, he really calmed us down.
Mm.
He did. I can hear him saying, no, Carl. Carl, that's not right. That's not right, Carl. That's not right. So we got it together. And, I mean, he came there and he changed us around. He changed our team. I mean, look at us. We have preachers. We have deacons.
Wow.
We thank him for that.
Wow.
So I'm going to say this from the gladiators. On your way to those pearly gates, Sidney, stop by, say hello to Peanut. Then go around the corner, say hello to Tim. Then go up the street, say hello to all the gladiators, and let them know it's time. Gladiators, mount up. I'm here. Sidney has finally made it home.
Amen.
We give praise to God and to each of you here. It's good to be here. I said it's good to be here.
It's good to be here.
I am thankful to this reverend clergy. I pastor the historic St. John Church in Third Ward down the street from the baseball field.
Wow.
On Emancipation. My wife is Uncle Bo's niece, First Lady Valerie Davis Malone. My mother-in-law, Catherine Davis, Aunt Gigi, and many of you, but I want to say this. Aunt Linda, you did your thing.
Amen.
And you ought to be celebrated this morning.
Amen.
Kim, we're praying for you. Y'all can clap. I got 2 minutes. Y'all can clap. Thankful to the members of the St. John Church and the members of our district who are here in support of Valerie. But let me say this as I go to my seat. I'm a fan of sitcoms, situational comedy. And one of my favorite, it was Archie Bunker's All in the Family. If you're not too holy, you remember All in the Family. George Jefferson was treated bad. George Jefferson was called out of his name. George was mistreated. But the other day, he and Weezy got a hold of some money. And they said these words, well, we're moving on up
Come on,
to the
man.
East side, to a deluxe apartment in the sky. They had on furs and they had on nice clothes, and they left their old life behind them because that old house was no more good. Uncle Bo moved on up the other day.
Yeah, man.
Not to the east side, but to a mansion. And who would want to stay in a broke down shack when you got a mansion to go home to? Well, he's in a place of no more crying, no more dying, no more pills, no more ventilators, no more suffering. And if you've been born again, you ought to be able to shout right here. I know you may be sad, but you ought to be glad that when you've been born again, I said when you've been born again, that you know you have somewhere to go. I'm not going to preach, and I got about 10 seconds, but I need to ask you this question. Is there anybody here who know you've got some place to go when you leave this place. I'm moving on up.
Praise his holy name to the Davis and Grant family. God be your strength. God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all you could ever ask, hope, or think. Kim, be encouraged, for we all have to go this way. It is appointed to all of us to lay at rest at some point in this life. So be encouraged. Be encouraged. Hold on to God's unchanging hand. Trust in him and never doubt him. If you allow him to, he will take care of you. Lily, God will take care of you. He's the one that can comfort you like no other. To the family, the siblings, God will take care of you. There's no better place to be than in the arms and safety of our Savior, Master and Redeemer, Jesus. Amen. I shall wear a crown. I shall wear a crown when it's all over. When it's all over, I shall wear a crown. Can you give me a little bit more volume? I shall wear a crown. Crown. When it's all over. When it's all over, I shall see his face. I shall see his face. His face when it's all over.
Oh, yeah.
Hallelujah. When it's all over, I'm gonna see my Jesus face. I'm gonna see the Master's face. Oh, yes, I am. When it's all over.
Oh, yeah.
Wait till that day. When it's all over, listen, I'm going to put on my robe, tell my story, how I made it over. Hey, I'm going to put on my robe. I've got a story to tell of how he brought me over through danger seen and unseen, through sickness, depression, stress, and all humanity. I gotta put on my robe. I gotta tell my story of how he brought me over, how he brought me on, how he kept me, how he never left me. I gotta put on my robe. I got a story to tell. It ain't all been good. I ain't always been easy. I ain't always did what he told me need to do. I'm gonna put on my robe. I'm gonna tell my story. I made it over. I'm going to put on my robe, tell my story, how I made it over. I can't wait to see my Savior's face. Oh, well, soon as I gets home, I can't hardly wait. I can't hardly wait. Just as soon as I get home, I can't wait to see the man that died for me, the one that saved and set me free. Just as soon as I get home, I'm counting the minutes, the hours, the days. Yes, just as soon as
pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come on this morning, as in times past, we come as humble as we know how, with the full realization that without you we can't do anything. And Lord, this your servant comes simply saying, Lord, help me. Speak to my heart. And in turn, Lord, I will share the word that you would have me to share with this your people. Lord, I'm asking that you would make every ear attentive to what you'd have to say today. Make every heart receptive to your word, so that in turn, our cups will be filled to overflowing with your grace, with your word of hope, with your word of encouragement on today. We ask, Lord, that you would just shower down your blessings upon your people today. We're in need of a word that would bind up broken hearts and mend wounded spirits on today. Simply saying, Lord, help us. Bless us, Lord. Make your presence evident throughout the rest of this service, as you've done prior to this. So, God, I thank you as I ask you for your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. Davis family, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. God bless you, brethren. You've been so kind. You can go ahead and take your seat. I'll go to my text in a moment. We thank you. The Lord, in his great wisdom, has called us together. We've answered a call today. I want to thank my wife, Geraldine, for being with us and express gratitude to several members of the Live Oak Church of God in Christ family who have traveled to Houston as a show of support to the Davis family. I again would like to thank Dr. Hall for being so gracious. Even as I spoke with him on the phone a few days ago, I could feel the warmth. Then after having arrived here today, we was met with such hospitality, and we could feel the love of Christ as it emanated from Dr. Hall, the ushers, his assistant pastor, Reverend Hunt, and to these so able deacons. And my heart was very delighted as he was introducing me and taking me about. And we went around this area, and he said, "This is another one of my very fine deacons, Deacon Burrell." And as he was approaching me, I say, "Clifton Burrell, it's been a many, many years. Brother Burrell and I were on the same track team. I was the only freshman on the varsity team, and he was a senior, and we went to state together, ran on the mile relay. We talked a little bit about that. I say, well, I can still run, but not quite as fast as I used to. Choir, I want to thank you. You blessed our hearts, and I thank the Lord for your pastor, Pastor Reverend O'Neill, who has so skillfully navigated us through this service. I leaned over to him. I said, "Is that Smyrna?" He said, "Yes, Smyrna." I said, "It sounds like you all have a good time on Sunday mornings." Amen. And I'm so grateful to all of the speakers who have spoken before me. Perhaps without your knowing it, the Lord were using you to give confirmation to what he would have me to say to this family on today. After having learned, and I'll speak more of Brother Sidney here in a bit, but after having learned of his demise, and after having been asked if I would stand in this place on today, I began to consult the Lord about what he would have me to say. A couple of things came to me, but then the Lord settled me in a place which I will share with you in a moment. And even this morning, I would estimate it was perhaps about 6 o'clock. My wife had asked me, "Have you got your message ready for today?" I said, "I'm working on it." Amen. And due in light of the fact that Brother Sidney was also a carpenter, these ministers, amen, put the final nail in the house. They began to talk about that house. Amen. God gave me, I sat there and I said, "Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord." I'm going to endeavor to be brief. Amen. And we come to Live Oak, maybe I'll finish it up. I do indeed bring you greetings from the Live Oak Church of God in Christ, where I have been blessed to pastor there for another couple of months, would be 37 years. Amen. Pastor three of the sisters, Sister Brenda, Sister Kathy, and amen, Sister Sonia, and just numerous family members of Brother Sidney. I thank God for this opportunity to be able to share with you and to offer a word of hope by the grace of God. I would like to call your attention to Paul's writing to the church at Corinth. 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter and verse 1. He says it this way: "For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens." For a little while today, I would like to encourage you with the words that will come from this subject: a better house. A better house. As I was contemplating this message on today, I thought about how there is something inherent in us that always causes us to want to better our situation. Sat there a few moments ago and I thought about that when a young couple begins their journey in life, in holy matrimony, one of the things they acquire is a home. Whether it be a rental, whether they're actually buying their first home, there's such a thing as a starter home, a starter house. They don't have everything that their hearts might desire to have in that home, but it gets them started. And as life moves on, as they're able to accumulate, as they advance in the workplace, as their finances begin to develop and increase, they come together and they have a discussion. They decide we need a better house. The family began to grow. We need a bigger house, a better house. And then life began to evolve, and time is time to move to an even better house. You know, I really would like, they say, I really would like a house maybe with a pool and a sun deck and all such as that. And they somehow manage to move to what they consider to be a better house. But in the midst of moving from house to house, they also note, as Apostle Paul tells us, that the houses that we live in this life, they do indeed dissolve. Right. They do indeed begin to decline and to deteriorate. We often have to do maintenance to try to keep them good, livable condition. And there we oftentimes do some things to keep it from deteriorating so quickly. Add a fresh paint job, replace a plank here and there. Amen. But still there's a yearning within us to have a better house. Paul here likened, amen, this earthly house, this tabernacle that we live in, he likened it to an earthly house. And he spoke of this house in which we live, these bodies. He spoke of them as being a temporary dwelling place. a tent, a place that is not permanent, a place that is movable, a place that is constantly going through changes. So if we think about these bodies in which we live, every day they are gradually deteriorating. They are gradually fading away. Sometimes so slightly so that we are not able to detect it. But how many know that we are indeed graveyard travelers? And that we did not come here to stay. We do things to try to, in our limited fashion, try to add some sense of permanence to these bodies, but they're not made to stay here.
No, sir.
Paul calls this body a tabernacle. Yeah. Amen. And we exercise. Some persons go to the gym. They walk, they run. We try to eat properly, doing all we can to stay here as long as we possibly can. But these old bodies are fading away. But Paul speaks with strong confidence. By virtue of the facts, he says that we know that if you've been born again, if you've gotten to know Jesus, you've got a real relationship with him, not just living on religion, but having a true relationship with God. Paul says that we know that if this earthly house, our tabernacle were to dissolve, we know that if this earthly tabernacle shall fade away, we have a building that's made of God. Hallelujah to his name. It's a building that's not made with hands. It is a home that's eternal in the heavens. Hallelujah to his name. I'm glad to know that I've got a better house. A better house than that one is made of brick and stone. I've got a better house that the wind and the rain does not dissolve. I've got a better house, a home eternal in the heavens. Hallelujah to his name. Brother Sidney, somebody says, moved out of this old house. Hallelujah to his name today. I'm going to miss those phone calls from Brother Sidney. I'm going to miss hearing him on Wednesday and Friday nights when he had occasion to call in on our teleconference. I'm going to miss seeing him at the family gathering in the month of May, for he did love his family. He did enjoy cooking for his family. I'm going to miss the barbecue and the fried fish. But Sidney had to move out to a better house. Just like the wind and the rain destroyed the house that we live in. We have tornadoes. There are fires. There are floods. There are earthquakes. All of these come to destroy the house. There's mold and mildew that destroy the houses that we live in at whatever address your address might be. And then there's sickness and disease that come against this earthly house. We have to deal with diabetes. We have to deal with cardiovascular issues. Sometimes we have breathing problems, pulmonary problems. Sometimes arthritis set in. And all of these things have an effect on this body. Hallelujah to his name. And there's that thing called cancer. All of these come to destroy this earthly house. But I'm glad, I said I'm glad that I've got a home that's eternal in the heavens. Glory be to God. I'm glad that this house is not made with hands. This house is eternal. And I can stand strong with the like confidence of Paul, saying we've got a better house. And why do I know we have a better house? Because I have the assurance of Jesus Christ himself, who said in St. John 14:1, saying, let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. He said, I'm gone away. I'm going away to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you might be also. He went on to tell us that in his Father's house, there were many mansions. How many glad to know that you got a mansion? A mansion on high. You got a better house. Glory be to God. So I encourage you today to live every day like it's your last day. Live every day like Jesus is coming back any moment. Live every day with the confidence of the Apostle Paul, who said to be present in this body is to be absent from the Lord. But to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. Hallelujah. One day, just a few days ago, Brother Sidney's earthly house, it gave in to the rigors of life. It gave in to the pain and suffering. He moved out. I said he moved out from this house to a brand new home. Hey, Lord, he's gone away. I said he's gone away to that new house. But I heard the wise man Solomon say in the 12th chapter of the book of Ecclesiastes that this house succumbs to the limbs growing weak, the eyes growing dim, the hair turning gray. Yes, Lord, this house can't last forever. We've got to move out to our brand new home. He's gone to a better house where the sun always shines. He's gone to a better house where it's always howdy, howdy, and never goodbye. He's gone to a better house where all of these negatives that we deal with in this life, they are not there. There's no sadness. There's no sorrow. It's hallelujah every day. He's gone to a place where the sun shines evermore. He's gone to a place where there's no heart problems, no cancer, no diabetes. Hallelujah. He's moved out of this old house. He's gone to a better house. He's taken off this corruptible. He's gone to a place where he's put on that glorious body. Come on, somebody say hallelujah. 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 Thank God for a better house. That's the hope that we live in today, that there is a better place. For if in this life only we have hope, then we'll be of all men most miserable. But we have hope beyond grave. We have hope of moving to a better house. God bless you. I trust you've been encouraged, that you look forward with great anticipation to moving from this earthly tabernacle to move into that better house that Jesus has prepared for us. Oh, bless his holy name. God bless you. God bless you.
tell them I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. Come on and lift that up. I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, if you want to know where I'm going, where I'm going soon, oh, I'm going up yonder, I'm going up yonder, up yonder, I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Why don't y'all help us lift that up? Oh, I'm going up beyond. I'm going up beyond. I'm going up beyond to be with my Lord. Going up beyond, I'm going up beyond to be with my Lord. I am going up beyond, I'm going up beyond. I want to see my Savior's face soon. Oh, I am going up, going up beyonder, going up beyonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up beyonder. His face. I gotta get my reward. I gotta see my master's face. I am going up yonder. One of these old days, it won't be very long. I'm gonna see him. I'm gonna see him face to face. I am going. I'm going up yonder. I gotta see his face real soon. One more time. I'm going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. I can't wait to see his face soon. If you want to know where I'm going, if anybody asks you, you tell them I'm going up yonder real soon.